Another day, another big solar company teetering on the edge of bankruptcy. Sunnova has been in the headlines since early March when it issued a going concern warning, which means the company is worried about its ability to stay in business. Now, if you don't know, Sunnova is one of the top five residential solar companies in the US. And if it goes under, it'll join a growing list of national solar companies that have closed their doors in the last few years. So, what's going on there? Are Americans not going solar anymore? Or are there other reasons why some of these solar giants are especially fragile? In this episode of Plugged In, we're exploring the dark side of big solar, why these major players are failing, and why it might actually be the best thing for solar growth in America. A quick reminder to like this video and hit subscribe to stay plugged into clean energy topics. Now, just to clarify, Sunnova is still in business as of now, despite its public announcement of troubles.
That's not good.
And its stocks plummeting to historic lows.
Okay, that's not good.
In March, a representative from Sunnova told Energy Sage, quote, "We are confident in our ability to manage our obligations and position Sunnova for long-term success," end quote. However, Sunnova has reportedly stopped material deliveries in Central California and stopped working with installers. That's according to Roth Capital Partners. But this episode isn't specifically about Sunnova. They're just the latest sizable solar company making news because of financial troubles. The first notable one was SolarCity about a decade ago. And interestingly, it was also the first company to center its business on offering solar panel leases through third-party financing. By 2016, SolarCity was in major debt and was acquired by Tesla. SolarCity's CEO also happened to be Elon Musk's cousin. Fast forward to the past 5 years, and we've seen a string of trouble for big solar. In 2022, Pink Energy went lights out. In 2023, it was Vision Solar. And in 2024, we said goodbye to ADT Solar, Titan Solar Power, and SunPower. And SunPower had been one of the major players in solar since 1985, so that one should have come as a surprise, right?
I haven't been surprised to see the bankruptcy of any of the national big box installers.
I don't think anyone who was following the industry was surprised.
Okay, so why are all these big solar companies failing? Well, I asked several industry experts, and here are the main reasons that came up. Shady sales practices that damage company reputation.
Whoever makes the most sales gets all you can eat sausages.
Expensive business models with complicated uses of debt.
You're in debt? What kind of debt?
You know, the kind where you owe a lot of money to people.
And heavy reliance on subsidies and third-party financing, which results in delayed pay.
I always pay you what's right.
You always think you pay me what's right. I always know when you pay me.
Let's hear first from Joe Mahermati. He's a longtime solar industry veteran who now helps installers grow their businesses. And he says he's been a little skeptical of how big solar operates.
Obviously, it's benefited from a lot of subsidies, and maybe that's one of the reasons that some of these larger publicly owned companies think that they can, you know, go door to door, coast to coast. But I don't think that business model is sustainable in the long run. I think that's proving itself out right now.
Joe says one reason some of these big companies are having a tough time is because of their door-to-door sales tactics.
It was sort of the get-rich-quick scheme of the last decade, 1099 solar sales.
Now, Joe's referring to the fact that some of these large companies outsource their sales teams, meaning that they hire salespeople who are great at selling but aren't attached to the company and might not understand the nuances of solar.
They're largely unaccountable, and they'll often make deals with homeowners that can't be guaranteed, that can't be installed, that are impractical. And that is really bad for the business they work for, and it's really bad for the solar industry.
Solar is a complicated product. It's not as simple as selling a vacuum or an internet package. So having a third-party salesperson who doesn't have experience in this technology, it doesn't bode well.
You're going to get substandard designs, and you're going to get substandard projects, and you're going to get a lot of angry homeowners.
Angry homeowners are also likelier to share their bad experiences with family and friends, and in some cases, they take it to court. Before going bankrupt, Vision Solar was sued, accused of pressuring customers into contracts and misrepresenting facts, among some other things, and they're not the only former solar company to face legal battles. So shady sales practices might contribute to why some big-name solar companies are crumbling, but it's a lot more complicated than that. So I recruited Paul Iscano. He's an analyst at Bloomberg New Energy Finance, and we're going to hear his take.
Most of the big solar companies have struggled because of essentially not having enough money in their coffers to repay back some of the debt that they have at the corporate level.
Big residential solar companies operate by raising two different types of debt. Corporate debt, like any other company, that they use to fund their internal operations, and non-recourse debt. And typically, these companies sign with a big lender that they can borrow money from to fund the solar projects that they sell to homeowners.
They're running very, very thin margins. So any slowdown in growth or any bad money spent can be detrimental for the company.
Paul says to raise money at the corporate level, these companies have to scale into new markets, either with more locations or by partnering with installers who will work under their company name.
To keep that running, you need a lot of overhead. The recurrent revenues that are coming in are not enough to keep that machine going.
It takes these large companies a lot of time and effort to make a single sale, and Paul says it's generally not worth it for them to expand into unfamiliar markets.
By the time you knocked on 200 doors, someone is willing to listen to you and actually decides to move forward and install a system, it's still going to take at least 2 to 3 months to get to the point where you install the system, and that's when you book your revenues.
A few months of delayed pay is actually pretty fast for this industry, which brings us to our next reason why big solar is struggling. Unlike many of the smaller solar companies, these giants rely heavily on selling solar leases and power purchase agreements, called PPAs. And to be clear, leases and PPAs aren't always bad. They can make going solar easier for more homeowners. But
whether it's scalable is another question. And having a publicly owned company that has a big part of their business model built on solar financing, or arguably all of their business model based on financing, I think is another question.
When homeowners pay for their solar panels with cash or a loan, the solar company typically gets paid quicker because the transaction stays between homeowner and installer. But with leases and PPAs, a third-party finance company is responsible for cutting those checks.
I've talked to a lot of installers. They don't get paid on time, and it impacts their business significantly. And that tells me that there's something unsustainable about the business model of some of those large publicly owned companies that are built entirely on financing.
So we've covered that big solar sometimes uses shady sales tactics, has a tough business model, complicated uses of debt, and delayed paydays. So their businesses are already on thin ice. And residential solar installations were down in 2024 after years of rapid growth. So coupled with other difficult market conditions like labor shortages, phasing out state incentives, the uncertainty of the federal tax credit, and high interest rates, it's not an ideal time to be a big solar company. But despite all of that, it's not all doom and gloom in the solar industry right now.
Talking to solar installers every day who are local, are regional, they're often growing. They're doing well. They're taking market share from those big box installers.
While the big solar companies are going dark, things are looking bright for the small and mid-sized companies. Why is that? Well, it certainly helps that they don't have large overhead costs and they don't use complicated forms of debt to finance their operations. But to explore the differences further, I spoke with Belker Gill, co-owner of Nova West Energy in Fresno, California.
Our small west company, we listen to the customer first and kind of understand what product they need, be it cash purchase, a loan, or a PPA option. I think in the case of someone like Sunnova or the larger guys, they are kind of a one-size-fits-all for the product. That can often lead into trouble.
Belker says small companies tend to fare better in the market because they focus on customer care from day one, and that extends beyond installation day.
I think that's a big difference sometimes working with the larger companies. When you make that first call, it ends up being an 800 number, and then it goes into an abyss of extensions, and you can't talk to anybody.
He says most small installers are focused on solar education, which sometimes means telling a homeowner why solar panels aren't a good option. But solar does make sense for many homeowners, especially right now where electricity rates are skyrocketing. But more on that in an upcoming episode. So even though these major installers are having a tough time, those who work with smaller and regional installers aren't worried because they've set up a more solid foundation.
A homegrown, vertically integrated businesses that believe in slow growth. I think that's the only business model that's sustainable in the solar industry.
Market analysts predict that more homeowners will install solar panels in the coming years. And Joe says the downfall of these major players will only help solar's growth.
There's going to be more people going solar because they're going to hear more positive stories about their neighbors going solar. I think a lot of what's held us back is just horror stories in the solar industry, people being scared of getting ripped off. And once those companies are gone, I think we're going to see a booming and thriving industry built on locally operated businesses.
Bottom line here, if you are considering solar, don't let the solar companies of days past scare you away. Just remember this.
If somebody knocks on your door trying to sell you solar, just say no. And if you're interested in solar, then my personal advice is to go to Energy Sage.
Okay, pause. I did not ask Joe to give Energy Sage a plug, but let's hear what he has to say.
I've seen firsthand how you do that, how you vet installers. I've seen how you ensure that the types of installers that are on your platform share your values of doing good work and being honest and doing right by the homeowner.
There you have it. If you are interested in solar, don't wait for a salesperson to knock on your door. Take matters into your own hands and reach out to a trusted installer. At the end of the day, it's tough to watch any solar company fall by the wayside, especially because it can make people skeptical of solar. I hope this episode clarifies that big solar companies aren't failing because solar panels are a bad product, but rather because they've built a house of cards, so to speak. Well, that's it for me. Thank you to Joe Belker and Paul for helping me tackle this rather large topic. Drop a comment with what you'd like to see next and stay plugged in.